Hi, I'm Vas Sadda. I'm professor of ophthalmology at UCLA and the Doheny Eye Institute. It's really exciting to be here at Euretina 2023 here in Amsterdam. We're very fortunate in retina that there are so many exciting new developments. Every year there's something new. And coming to a meeting like Euretina is an opportunity to really learn about them. And so especially now, currently in the disease space, something that's very exciting are new treatments that we have for now geographic atrophy, and also new agents even for the treatment of wet macular degeneration. And so coming here to this meeting, I think that yes, we have the treatments, we have the trial data, many of us are aware of that, but hearing from our colleagues, understanding how they're actually implementing these therapies in practice, this is one of the things I really look forward to in coming to a meeting like Euretina. So I think there are a lot of exciting developments in diagnostic technologies in retina. I think all of us recognize the power of multimodal imaging, and having multimodal imaging devices, single platform that can provide a variety of different types of imaging, dye-based angiography, OCT angiography, OCT, wide-field imaging. I think those are really exciting because there's a proliferation of those, and I think that allows us to better study disease in our patients. We're in this new era of molecular and cellular-based therapeutics, and I think that's increased the need to have these kinds of diagnostic tools. So I think that's something we can be excited about going forward. I think other things that are emerging are things like home diagnostics, and actually just providing access to technology in more convenient locations for patients. Now that we have artificial intelligence, deep learning-based tools for doing things like diabetic retinopathy screening, I think we can expect further deployment of AI technologies married to our imaging devices that allow us to be more efficient in our care of patients. One of the things that's very exciting being here at Euretina again is that we have new therapeutics that are upon us, especially I often talk about the fact that we're in this era of treatment for dry AMD or geographic atrophy. So we have two agents now that are FDA cleared, more that are under study. And so now the real onus is on us as physicians to find these patients. And many of these patients, for example, I'll just focus on geographic atrophy in particular, these patients are actually, many of them are in optometric practices. They're actually not even seeing ophthalmologists or retina specialists because we didn't have treatments for them before. And so now there's really a premium to have technologies where you can screen for these patients. Perhaps you can do, again, you can do imaging technologies combined with AI to detect this disease more rapidly and then get these patients in for therapy. I think that's the real opportunity here in these next few years. And because of the fact that that these patients with geographic atrophy, they're in these optometric practices, and we know that these general practitioners in vision care, they many of them have devices like Optos devices to do ultra-widefield imaging. And ideally, we'd like to be able to capture patients like that, have images like that, and be able to diagnose geographic atrophy using those images. And we haven't had previous validation of doing geographic atrophy measurements using ultra-wide-field green autofluorescence images. I mean, there are some potential considerations that you might expect maybe it wouldn't perform so well. You're really zooming in on the macula. You're not getting an averaged image. You know, how does that impact our ability to actually assess atrophy? So a study that we've been doing that I discussed here at Euretina as well is actually trying to validate using ultra-wide-field green autofluorescence imaging for identifying and measuring atrophy. And we're able to show that using masked graders, independent graders, that this could be done very reliably and could compare quite nicely to other conventional methods. And so I think that really holds promise for us in using this out in clinical practice, as well as in future clinical trials, to be able to use ultra-wide-field green autofluorescence imaging to do these assessments.